Hello, hello and good afternoon. Thank you very much for joining the Biennale del Pensament here in Barcelona. We kicked off this morning and will go on until Sunday. The topic for this afternoon is interesting and worrying. The future we'll be discussing with two historians that have been reflecting about the future. Mr. Harari, good afternoon, Mr. Harari.
Hello, it's good to be here.
And we have also Mr. Bregman here live
as well.
Thank you.
Sapiens, a brief history of humanity, in which Noah Harari looks back, looks at our origin, in order to try and understand where we stand today. In Homo Deus, he looked forward, he looked towards the future, in order to try and understand the ambition of humankind to become gods. And in 21 Lessons for the 21st Century, he tried to answer to very pressing challenges before the COVID-19 pandemic. So the present today is very different, which does not mean that the 21 lessons are invalid or not timely anymore. And one of the quotes from the book proves that change happened so rapidly, much more rapidly than we can even imagine. So the three books can be found in Ediciones 62 in Catalan and Debate in Spanish. And then there's another book, Imparables, in Spanish, a diary on how we dominated Earth, which has been published in Catalan and in Spanish by Estrella Polar and Montena. And it's the same message for a younger audience. Bregman is also the author of Utopy for Realists and Humanity, a History of Hope. Dignos de Ser Humano is a title in Spanish published by Anagrama. So, in Utopy for Realists, he reminds us that the present, at the end of the day, is the utopy of the past. And he quotes journalist and writer Galeano when he says that, indeed, utopy is essential to move forward. When we lose utopic ideas, there's no reason to keep living. Whereas in the second book, you preserve your optimism, even if today optimism is more needed than ever. We are a little bit fed up of bad news and pessimism. Again, in the second book, Bregman asks himself on whether it's not a matter of how we ask ourselves questions, right? Sometimes we look at things very negatively because we ask ourselves probably the wrong questions. So in fiction, there's always interest in evil, in the dark side of humankind, whereas reality shows that, well, there are many bad news, right? In the news, we only hear about bad news. And he proves that cooperation between human beings have been essential for evolution, and Harari would add a narrative, right? It's very important to have a narrative in order to convince the masses, societies, and communities as to us being here the way we are. I believe we are at a turning point. We face a nuclear threat. We are amidst the war in the Ukraine. There is an incredible rise of the extreme right movements, not to speak about the economic crisis, unprecedented, or let's say, let's not remember the precedents. Then there's an energy crisis, a global energy crisis, not to speak about the climate crisis. And probably it should be the first one to be enumerated because it explains the rest of crisis. And we are experiencing all this crisis after a pandemic which was meant to make us better, right? Everyone said, oh, we're going to build back better. Even the UN said that. So there is some sort of a pre-apocalyptic environment, like if we were experiencing apocalypses in the first person. So I would like to start by the end, maybe, and asking Mr. Harari the following. Well, Harari, in 21 Lessons for the 21st Century, you say that panic in a context of uncertainty is a form of arrogance, because panic is based on the idea that we know what is going to happen and where the world is headed towards, to its own extinction, right? And you say that at moments of uncertainty, perplexity is important, because at the end of the day, perplexity makes us humble, and perplexity allows us to look at our environment with a certain degree of, let's say, clarity.
I don't think that history is deterministic, which is why we can't predict the future, and we can't be certain that the apocalypse is coming or the end of the days are coming. This is something humans always felt, that some huge, terrible calamity is just around the corner. Sometimes it happened, it depends when you're born, but often it doesn't. Instead of trying to kind of prophesize the future, I think the key thing is to realize that the future depends on the decisions we take in the present. It's not written anywhere. Humanity has enormous power. All the problems that you've mentioned are very big problems, very worrying problems. I worry a lot about them. But none of them is an inevitability. None of them is unsolvable. Humanity has not just the scientific knowledge. We actually have the economic resources to solve all the problems that you've mentioned, including even climate change. I'm worried, actually, about people losing hope, about people feeling that this is now too late to stop the ecological catastrophe. It's not true. We don't have a lot of time, but if we make the right decisions, we have the economic resources and the scientific knowledge to prevent it. It's estimated that if we invest just about 2% of the global budget, the global GDP, in the right technology and infrastructure, this should be enough to prevent catastrophic climate change. Now, 2% of the global budget is a lot of money, but it's still just 2%. We're actually very good as a species in shifting this amount of resources from here to there. The problem isn't some kind of inevitable destiny. And the problem isn't the lack of resources. The problem is really just bad political decisions. And yes, to be honest, when I look at the world today in the last few years, then we are running in the wrong direction. So I can't say that I'm optimistic. Maybe it will all go to waste. Maybe the civilization that we've built will collapse. But it's not inevitable. It's because of our decisions, and it's not too late to make different decisions.
Señor Bregman.
Mr. Bregman, you argue that the last 200 years have been the best 200 years that humanity has ever experienced, and you also say that the present is a utopia of the past in the Middle Age. We could never imagine that the majority of disease would be under control, that extreme poverty would be limited to a limited amount of the population, or that it would be very easy to get food popping up in a supermarket or click and have it delivered at home. So we've reached a moment in which we have everything we need. There's nothing else we need, right? So also, desires are forecasted for us. They are pre-designed. We have more desires than we even imagined in the past. So from this perspective, in the present times, how can we think about the future, and how can we keep this utopia going?
So it's interesting that most people throughout human history thought they were living at the end. They thought that, you know, society could collapse any moment, or there would be some kind of apocalypse, or, you know, people would go to heaven and some would go to hell. But it was almost over. That's what most people thought. And now, for the first time, probably in human history, we could actually be at the beginning of something that is really, really big. Now, you could easily argue that, I mean, you're absolutely right, this is perhaps also the most dangerous century in all of human history, and it's not just nuclear war, but now it's also the rise of new technologies, such as synthetic biology, you know, the ability to create very dangerous viruses in the lab, or the rise of artificial intelligence, you know, could perhaps be one of the most dangerous technologies on the horizon. But then if we play our cards right, we could expand into the universe, and we could be, you know, just at the beginning of something huge. You know, if you look at, you know, the metaphor, there's a philosopher called Will McCaskill who says, maybe humans are just in their teenage years, or maybe we even just toddlers, or maybe we were just babies, you know, who just came out of the womb, blinking. That could be true, you know. The future could be vast, again, if we play our cards right. Now, I think it's very important that we have something to strive for. Some of the utopians you mentioned, one thing that's important to keep in mind here is that we still live in an incredibly unequal world. So I recently looked up the numbers. If you earn a median wage in the Netherlands, where I'm from, just a median wage, you're already part of the 3.5 richest in the world. So we all remember Occupy Wall Street with their slogan, "We are the 99%." And that's true if you live in a rich country and you look at, you know, the very, very rich at the top. But actually, most of us, you know, globally speaking, are part of at least the richest 5%. And then the question is, what kind of responsibilities come with that, right? I agree with Yuval that there's just so much low-hanging fruit. We do have the means and the abilities and the technologies to solve some of the greatest problems out there. Still today, 5.5 million children die every year from easily preventable causes. Why haven't we solved it? We have made great progress. Child mortality has gone down a lot. Extreme poverty has gone down a lot. But still, compared to our abilities, you know, we're nowhere where we actually should be. So yeah, it's like Charles Dickens once wrote, it's the worst of times, it's the best of times, or was it the other way around? It's a very paradoxical time to be alive.
Yes, you refer to wealth, and this question is for both of you. So my opinion is the following. No one ever taught us how to lose, right? And some people say that, you know, perhaps we should start thinking about deceleration or degrowth, and well, for large corporations, this is a scary, right? But it's true that here in Western countries, at least, the more the better, the more the merrier. Like if resources were unlimited, and growth could go on forever. So a couple of weeks ago, here in Barcelona, we see all the satellites that Elon Musk has launched into the space, and that are filling the space with spatial waste. So more and more, there are famous and VIP people that use private jets to move around the world, and we are amidst a climate crisis, not to speak about the winter games that are going to be held in the Emirates, in the middle of the desert, a city that will cost $500 billion. So, wow, how can we justify all these events, and how can we accept the situation in which we stand? Who would like to start?
Perhaps Yuval.
Okay. So I'll say two things. I mean, about growth. It is indeed the most important ideal of modernity is growth. The idea, it will solve everything. And you see almost all regimes, all ideologies, all religions accepting it. It doesn't matter if you call yourself socialist or capitalist, Jewish or Muslim or atheist, a dictatorship or a democracy, everybody believes in growth. It's kind of the number one goal. Now, and there is a lot of criticism of growth that is unsustainable, but the two things I wanted to say is first, that for much of the world, growth is simply essential. We can talk in the West about degrowth. We can talk in affluent societies about degrowth or stopping growth. But in much of the world, people don't have toilets. People don't have running water. People don't have electricity to cook. So they need to burn wood, and it causes them lung problems. So these people, they need growth. And these are billions of people. So we have and if everybody around the world would reach a tolerable basic level of comfort, this would be terrible ecological news unless we find ways to grow in a sustainable way. So for most people, degrowth is not really an option. The question is how to grow in a sustainable way. When you look at also the rich people, I think I wouldn't frame it as degrowth, because people don't want, as you said, people don't like to lose. People don't want to go back. People don't want to have less. The question is, what do people really want? What do they need? The deep psychological and social needs and spiritual needs of humans We need to have growth in that, but we just need to find ways how to grow psychologically and socially and spiritually in a way that doesn't destroy the planet. So, if you think like, I don't know, about, again, you mentioned vacations abroad. So some people could travel halfway across the world and with enormous ecological footprint in order to connect with friends, in order to, you know, enjoy nature, maybe in order to have some deep spiritual experience. Now, the thing is, you can have all that without this huge ecological footprint. We need to find ways. Yes, we shouldn't tell people, no, you now give up on your desire, on your need to connect with your friends. Just find better ways to do it. And to give one last final example, like, I don't know, with music, that it is a small change, but it's still significant, that the shift from having physical records and CDs and so forth to having everything digital, ecologically, it was a very good shift. It's less stuff, physical stuff, being produced and moved around. But we didn't tell people you have to give up music. It's causing too much pollution around the world. We find an even better way to share and enjoy music, which doesn't harm the ecological system so much.
So I think that degrowth is probably the worst slogan in the history of leftist political thought.
It's not a really great way to win a lot of votes if you say, vote for me, you'll get less.
Oh. Agafa el meu. Mentre te passen...
Grab mine while you get a new one.
No, that's degrowth in action.
Yeah.
Is this one? Terrific. Okay, so as I said, degrowth is probably, you know, one of the worst political slogans ever. It's just a very hard way to get additional votes if you say, yeah, vote for me, you'll get less. I think it's important, though, that there is the rise of what you could call bullshit in the Western world. There's this phenomenon from described by the anthropologist David Graeber, that some of you may know. He passed away, sadly, recently. But he had this concept that he called bullshit jobs. And it's very striking. You see it a lot, especially in Western countries, is that there are a huge amount of people working in jobs that they don't really care about, that don't contribute anything of value to society. And it's not me saying that. Some people may say, okay, Yuval and Rutger are historians. That's like the definition of socially useless. But that's not how it works. People decided for themselves, right? And then we see in modern polls and some recent evidence that around 25% of people in the modern workforce in rich countries think that their own job doesn't add anything of value to society. Now, who are these people? It turns out that they're very often highly educated people, you know, with beautiful resumes, who went to great universities, but still at the end of the day, they feel they don't contribute anything. They're more often than not corporate lawyers or consultants or bankers. So I'm not saying that all of consultancy and all of banking, et cetera, that all of that is useless, but it is striking that there are so many super smart, talented, and ambitious people who privately feel they don't contribute anything. And that's where we need perhaps a different philosophy of growth, that we need to redefine what growth actually is. Who are the real wealth creators in our society? So often it seems to be that we live in a world that's upside down, where the people who do the most valuable jobs get the least in terms of their salary, and the people who pollute the most or don't contribute all that much earn the highest salaries. I mean, this is not always the case, obviously, but it seems to be the case quite often. So that's the question I think we got to ask here. Who are the real wealth creators in our society? Where does it come from?
And say something, about, you know, bankers and people like that, that it's sometimes very difficult even for themselves to understand what they contribute to society, and some of them don't contribute to society or even harm society by the things they do, but the thing they really produce is trust. The most important, the most valuable resource in the world is not oil, and it's not gold, it's trust. If you can get the trust of a lot of people to and work together, you can accomplish almost anything. And the entire banking system, it's not really about money, it's about trust. Money itself is a sort of liquid trust. It's, I mean, taking my money and using it to build something on the other side of the world. This is how the modern economy functions. Now, there is a question of trust. I mean, I don't know these people. Why would I give my money to some factory on the other side of the world that I never visited and I don't know? What bankers do, they create these extremely complicated mechanism of building trust between billions of strangers, which is the kind of framework, it's the kind of pillars of the whole modern economy. We see it when it goes wrong. When, for instance, a currency, which everybody trusted, suddenly loses its value. Then we realize, hey, actually building a currency, creating this kind of imaginary financial instrument that billions of people trust, this is very difficult, and it's also extremely essential. So again, I'm not saying that all bankers are contributing to society, but it is important to realize not to go too far with this idea. You know, in Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, they have this idea of let's get rid of all the bullshit jobs, and of course the civilization collapses.
Well, you know, there's one example that I know of when bankers went on strike. And this happened in Ireland in 1970, and that strike lasted for 6 months, and nothing much happened, actually, you know? After 6 months, the bankers came back and said, all right, we'll get back to work. And so, I don't know, that's the only historical case study that I know of. I think we have a slight disagreement about where the trust in our money comes from. I don't think it's a myth that, you know, the bankers make us believe in. I think it's actually because of our governments. So imagine that the government comes to you and says, okay, you got to pay your taxes. I mean, annually you got to pay your taxes, obviously over your income. And then you say, look, I just read this fantastic book by Yuval Noah Harari, and he argues that actually money is just a myth. You know, it's just something that we all believe in. So, you know, this year, this time around, I've decided, yeah, I'm not paying. It's not necessary. I don't believe in money, so I'm not doing it. I think that what's probably going to happen is that the government will, you know, take you and put you in prison. So I think it's important to recognize that behind this myth is not, you know, the storytelling of the banker. No, it's a guy with an AK-47 or, you know, some other kind of weapon. It's the power of the government that makes you believe in this. You just have to believe in this. I think that's, in this case, what guarantees people's trust. They are basically being forced.
Even though it goes both ways. I mean, the guy with the AK-47 comes knocking at your door because he or she get paid at the end of every month so and so many euros or so and so many gold coins. So he's willing to do it. But if everybody loses trust, if just one person loses trust in money, yes, they just throw him in jail or in the street or whatever. If everybody would lose trust, the whole thing would collapse. Now, of course, I completely agree that it's not just bankers. I mean, it's an alliance between the financial institutions and the political institutions that make this thing run. But both sides have to play an important role. And again, it's easy, and I often also do it, it's easy to kind of make fun of it, or it's easy to criticize it, as this entire thing is one huge Ponzi scheme guarded by people with Kalashnikovs. But it's also the foundation of a taxation system that is the foundation of our healthcare system. The taxes that I pay, ideally, in a good country, are used to pay the salaries of nurses and doctors on the other side of the country who take care of complete strangers that I've never met before, but still my taxes help save them from disease. So it, without money, for instance, how to keep a taxation system running and how to keep a healthcare system running, I think, you know, there are many utopian visions on how to do it. I'm not aware of any large-scale experiment that actually succeeded.
Sure, sure. So I think I would agree that, obviously, finance is a very important and useful service industry. But that's what it is, right? It should enable other sectors of the economy to function better. If we look at one of the best periods in you know, Western history, you know, after the Second World War, when we had enormous economic growth, a huge amount of innovation. Back then, the financial sector was pretty small. The consultancy sector was pretty small. You know, there were relatively little, few corporate lawyers, and we had a huge amount of innovation. But today, if you study at one of the best universities in the world, Harvard University, 45% of people go into either finance or consultancy. Again, I'm not saying that all consultants, you know, have a bullshit job, that all bankers have a bullshit job, but it seems pretty clear to me that one of the great tragedies of our time is this extraordinary waste of talent. So many smart people doing things that, you know, are not the next big thing, are not, you know, really, they're not really working on the world's most pressing problems.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Yeah.
So now, from money to technology, Mr. Harari, you alerted during the COVID-19 pandemic, you alerted about freedoms, and you said that the freedoms that we were losing under the excuse of lockdown, etc., would not be recovered easily. Sometimes I have the feeling like we are not so concerned about losing freedoms because day after day our privacy is violated by technology. And in theory, technology makes our life easier. So we accept this violation on our privacy with no questioning. So how is it possible that we've reached a moment in where there is no debate about technology, which is disrupting our lives, disrupting societies, and we accept quite happily that our privacy is violated, that we are being chased in the street by phones and cameras? Perhaps it's one of the most pressing challenges we face, isn't it?
Yeah, it's an extremely pressing challenge. There is some debate, but not enough. I think people don't realize the enormity of the danger we are facing. So to put it simply, for the first time in history, it's now technically possible to completely annihilate privacy. For all of history, you had debates about the limits of privacy. But there was always a certain level of privacy that was impossible to take away from you. Because even in totalitarian regimes, I don't know, let's go to Franco's Spain. So you have the secret police in Franco's Spain watching people, monitoring people, but they can't watch everybody all the time. There are, I don't know what, like 40 million, 50 million people in the whole of Spain. The secret police doesn't have 50 million agents to follow you around 24 hours a day and see everything you do and say and whatever. And even if they have an agent that can follow around everybody, the really big problem is to analyze all the information. You know, at the end of every day, the agent that followed you sits down and writes a report on what you did, what you said, who you met. And this is a piece of paper. And they send it to headquarters in Madrid. And there they have a mountain of paper, millions and millions of reports coming in every day about every person in Spain. Somebody, to make it useful, somebody needs to read all these reports and analyze them and find patterns, whatever. This is impossible. So there was some level of privacy even in Franco's Spain. Now it's technically possible to completely annihilate it. Why? Because it's possible to follow everybody all the time. You don't need human agents. You have cameras and microphones and algorithms and smartphones. People are paying for the agent from their own money, and they take the agent everywhere. A secret agent in Franco's Spain, usually, even if they followed you, they didn't go with you to the toilet. They weren't with you in the bedroom when you have sex. But your smartphone is there. You know, you have all these people who talk about putting chips, implanting chips in brains. They don't understand it's not the chips in the brains they should be worried about. The technology doesn't exist, this technology. They should worry about the smartphones, where they read all the conspiracy theories about the chips in the brains. And it's not just you can follow everybody all the time. For the first time, you can analyze these mountains of data, because you don't need human analysts to go over all these pieces of paper. It's all digital, and we have AI and machine learning that can analyze it. So it is becoming technically feasible to completely annihilate human privacy and follow everybody all the time. And it's already being increasingly done in some countries in the world. And if we are not careful, if we don't stop it, if we don't regulate it, it will lead to the rise of the worst totalitarian regimes in human history, far, far worse than anything we've seen in the 20th century, like the Franco regime or Nazi Germany or the Soviet Union.
So I guess I would agree that what we're seeing now, particularly in places like China, is just absolutely terrifying, that just dictators have possibilities now that indeed would have been unthinkable for people like Hitler and Stalin. Perhaps it's useful to make a distinction between this autocratic form of surveillance and the more like capitalist form of surveillance, because, you know, people like us, we worry a lot about what does Facebook know about us, you know, what does Google know about us, et cetera, et cetera. And there, I think we need a little bit more nuance, perhaps. So we all remember the election of Donald Trump. We were all looking for an explanation. How could this have happened? Also, it also happened after Brexit, right? How was this possible? How was it done? And there were big stories in the news at the time. For example, there was this company called Cambridge Analytica. Maybe you guys remember this, that supposedly had access to a huge amount of data from Facebook, where they, that they used in order to manipulate large amounts of Americans into voting for Trump. I think that was almost all nonsense. So if you actually look at the amount of data they had, you know, per person of those Facebook users, it was just they knew about a couple of likes. That's it. And later researchers tried to basically let the computer guess what the genders were of all these people, and that was even difficult. So the whole idea that just with a data set that can't even predict people's genders, that would have been useful enough to manipulate a huge election, you know, in a very big country, I think that was just what I would call a progressive conspiracy theory. A lot of people were blaming the fake news in Cambridge Analytica, but they couldn't face up to the fact that Clinton was just a really bad candidate, and that actually it was the real news. It was CNN that was more of the problem instead of the Russians interfering. So I think it's important to keep our discussion in line with the actual technology here. And a lot of the worries, I think, about surveillance capitalism are way overblown. I mean, you have authors now proclaiming that we have like lost the will to will, and that we are like these puppets in the hands of our Facebook overlords. I think if you look at the actual evidence, and there's some great economic research here, is like how effective, for example, is online advertising, and it's very, very underwhelming, actually. So that's important to keep in mind, I think.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, you were reflecting about how Donald Trump won the American election, so that was interesting. But this is happening more and more often, because the nuclear threat had not been mentioned for 60 years, and now we are all speaking about the nuclear threat. And even in a very, let's say, we're speaking about the Armageddon submarine that could destroy New York in a blink, it was taboo, whereas today we speak about it as if it were normal. Not only this, we could never have imagined that in the 21st century we would experience a conventional war in Europe, in the Ukraine. If 10 years ago I was told that 20 years after we would stand where we stand, I would not have believed it, and I would have found it horrifying. And the question comes here, do we have to get used to uncertainty? Do we have to get used to frightening new realities, realities that you cannot even imagine today? Do we really have to get used to these crazy roller coaster up and downs? Do we have to start accepting that things are totally unforeseeable, that we are not God, that will never be God, because our reality will be disrupted forever in the future. Mr. Harari, would you like to start?
Yeah, I mean, it was always the situation. I mean, we could never predict the future. The future was always, created by decisions made in the present and by accidents. So there is nothing new about that. And as we become more and more powerful, yes, it gives us more control. But then if somebody makes a bad decision, the consequences are also far more horrendous. So I think we need to get used to it, because this was always the situation. But it shouldn't make us kind of give up our responsibility. All these catastrophes are increasingly our own doings. For much of history, the unforeseen catastrophes that befell humans were not their own fault, or at least not directly their own fault. If you think about something like the Black Death, this was an uncontrollable force of nature. It was helped along by humans. I mean, the fact that humans opened these trade routes throughout Eurasia made it easier for pathogens, for diseases to travel. So this partly explains the Black Death, but ultimately it was a force beyond human control. When it came and killed about between a quarter and half the population of Europe and the Middle East and Asia, nobody understood what was happening. Nobody knew how to stop it. They had these theories that it's punishment from God, or it's black magic, or it's the Jews, or whatever. But nobody knew the truth. They were helpless. In the face of the COVID pandemic, situation is very different. It took 2 weeks to identify the virus. It took a year to develop several effective vaccines. We are not helpless in the face of pandemics anymore. So a pandemic is now a political failure. It's not a natural disaster. The same way famine, and we are seeing a rise of famine all over the world, there is no longer any natural famine in the world. For much of history, famine was a natural disaster. There was drought, there was flood, there was famine. Nobody could do much about it. Now, the only famine that exists is political famine. It's famine because some politician wants there to be famine or doesn't do enough to prevent it. And it's the same with war. For much of history, you could think that war is just, part of human nature, part of nature. That's no longer the case. We've shown in recent generations that we are capable of building international institutions and norms that drastically reduce international violence. We have been living in the most peaceful era in history, not because of some miracle of God, but because of institutions that humans built. And now we are entering a new era of war, not because, the devil did something, but because humans neglected the institutions that they built. It's like you build a dam over a river, and then you neglect it. It falls down, you do nothing, you have a flood. And if you talk about the decline of the institutions that kept world peace, so we talked about the 2016 Trump elections and Brexit. It started there. The countries which were the leaders in building the rule-based international system over the last few decades, they signaled that they are abandoning it. They don't care about it anymore. So it's no wonder that the institutions are falling apart, and that we are coming back to the jungle, to the era of war. But this is all human action, and therefore it's not too late to reverse course and to rebuild the dams, to rebuild the institutions that protect us from war, from famine, from pandemics.
So recently I've been thinking a lot about this question of how the historians of the future will look at us. How will they judge us, how we're living, in the 21st century? For us, it's fairly easy to look back on, say, the Middle Ages or the 17th and the 18th century and to condemn those horrible people who lived in the past. I mean, they did so many horrible things. They engaged in witch hunts. They, engaged in slave trading. Just to think about the enormous size of the transatlantic slave trade, you know, what is it, 12 million people transported across the Atlantic Ocean. Think about the Inquisition. Think about so many horrible punishments that were given to criminals and public hangings, etc., etc. So it's very easy to judge those people in the past. And then we look at ourselves and we think, oh, we live in democratic societies. We've got, you know, the equality between the sexes. Women've got the right to vote. We've built a welfare state. There's still a lot of to do, but surely we are pretty civilized. But maybe not. Maybe we are doing some things today that the historians of the future will be absolutely horrified by, just as we are very horrified by the slavery of the past. And then the question is obviously, what could those things be, right? What are some of the really bad things that we're doing today? And I would agree with Yuval that it's probably things that we already know about. I mean, the facts are there. Just to give you one example, every single week there's a new paper that comes out about animal cognition, just how similar animals in factory farms are to us. So take pigs, for example. Pigs are incredibly curious creatures. You know, they're capable of empathy, they make friends, etc., etc. They're pretty similar in many ways to humans. But yeah, we treat them absolutely horribly, and most of us know it. There are very striking results from polls. There was recently a poll in the US where they asked people if we should ban slaughterhouses. And 50% of Americans said, yeah, we should ban slaughterhouses. And the researchers couldn't believe it. And they said, then they asked a follow-up question, do you realize that, you know, actually we slaughter animals in slaughterhouses so that you can eat meat? And then still, three-quarters of people still agreed. But then, I mean, the percentage of vegetarians and vegans is obviously very small. So this is just one example of something that could be considered one of our greatest crimes by the historians of the future, but that we don't think about all that much. And maybe there are many other examples. I mean, the way we treat criminals, for example, we lock people up. Maybe in the future, we'll know much more about the human brain, and we realize that actually people who commit crimes actually have suffered brain damage. You know, in a way, they're patients, they're victims, and they should be treated with therapy instead of punishment. So you could imagine a whole sorts of things that actually we may be standing on the wrong side of history today, but the question is, then what are some of the bad things we are doing today?
But perhaps there's no need to go back to the animal world, which is very interesting, by the way, but the refugees, the crisis here in Europe is just horrifying. In your book, Humanity, A History of Hope, you talk about real histories, real cases, and you raise the importance of cooperation and solidarity. Of course, there have been many displays of solidarity during the pandemic, during the war in the Ukraine, but we've also seen massacres in the Donbas, and more we see horrifying situations, inhumane situations, which are also part of humankind. I agree, it's possible to avoid war, it's possible to avoid wrongdoings, but at the same time, this is happening as we speak, right? In the present.
Absolutely. You know, humans are obviously really malleable. And one of the disturbing facts about humans is that when we do very bad things, we often don't really feel as the bad guys, right? Probably many of you will have seen the Batman movies, you know, with the Joker, you know, the typical bad guy. And the Joker just enjoys making other people suffer. You know, he's a classical sadist. And I'm not saying these people don't exist. Sure, there are some people who just really enjoy seeing other people in pain, but they're very, very rare. You know, it's a very small percentage of the population. Most crimes are committed by people who believe they're actually on the good side of history. And this is, I'm not saying this to condone anything. I find it's actually a very disturbing fact about humans. And indeed, the way we treat migrants is one example. It's easy for us to forget that we still live in a world of global apartheid, where just the fact that you have a certain passport already determines 60% of your income. So your passport is the most valuable possession you have in this world, at least if you live in the right country, right? So for us, we can travel around the globe, but then many other people in poorer countries, they can't. That is a form of apartheid, you could argue. We usually only see that when the migrants come here, who are actually relatively rich, you know, it's the relatively richer migrants who can actually afford to come here, right? If you're really poor, you can't even afford to come here. And then we start seeing it, and we feel conflicted about it. But it's still, yeah, it's as I said, we live in a world that has made a lot of progress, but still there's incredible inequality, and there's just so much to do still.
Refer to that. Mm-hmm. I think I absolutely agree that most of the big crimes in history were done by people who thought they were doing good. And also we probably do a lot of terrible things that we are only half aware of, or we are not aware of. This is why I think the best thing society can do about it is have strong self-correcting mechanisms. To start with the assumption that we make mistakes, and we are not sure what the mistakes are. And we need to bake into the cake, to bake into the system, mechanisms that allow us over time to identify and correct our mistakes. You mentioned, for instance, the Atlantic slave trade and slavery in general. And it's today, you know, very, very common to point out and blame, say, the American founding fathers, that they signed the Declaration of Independence with all these promises for rights of liberty and equality and so forth, and some of them have slaves, and they don't see it, or they somehow ignore it. But what could be said for the founding fathers of the United States, at least they established self-correcting mechanisms that eventually enabled the system to identify and acknowledge its own failings and mistakes and correct them to some extent, which is quite rare in history. Because most human institutions, or at least the most important ones, they tend to believe in their own infallibility. You know, you have the Catholic Church with a doctrine of papal infallibility, that they just can't be wrong, at least on certain matters of faith and morality. And it's interesting, you know, in recent times you saw the Pope apologizing for at least certain mistakes, certain crimes in the Catholic past, like the persecution of Jews, or recently the crimes committed in Catholic schools in Canada against Native Americans. But when you actually read the apology, it's interesting, they never admit a mistake on the part of the church as an institution, or of Christianity, or of Christian teaching, or certainly not the Bible. They always blame it on certain individuals within the institution that misunderstood the true Christian teachings, which is why they never, for example, publish a new edition, corrected edition of the Bible. You know, science is another institution that corrects itself over time. We have a theory, after some time we discover it's wrong, we acknowledge, hopefully, that it's wrong, and we publish a new book, we publish a new paper. But, you know, in the Ten Commandments, you actually have an endorsement of slavery. In the Tenth Commandment, that thou shalt not covet, it says that you shouldn't covet your neighbor's slave, which implies that it's perfectly fine to have slaves, it's just not fine to covet your neighbor's slaves. This is something God disapproves of. And it's still there. You know, even in 2022, the Ten Commandments still endorse slavery. And it's unthinkable that they'll publish a corrected edition. Now we know better. Now we know it was wrong to endorse slavery. So I think that the important thing, we can't be completely pure, ethically free of all mistakes. We are bound to make more mistakes. The best we can do is build institutions that are able to admit their own mistakes. Scientific institutions are one example. Democracy is another example. The whole idea of democracy is to build these self-correcting mechanisms, like periodic elections. We voted for the wrong guy, wrong person 4 years ago. Let's try something else today. Independent courts, independent media, they are all self-correcting mechanisms. In contrast to a dictatorship, that is never able to admit mistakes, or rarely able, like we now see with Putin in Ukraine, that just keeps insisting on his initial mistake, is completely unable, the entire system, to to admit that they just made a terrible mistake.
Indeed, down this line, Mr. Harari, in Sapiens, you say that the pillar of civilization is gossip, that more and more gathers more and more people in the Bible, around the Catholic Church, around religions, nations, etc., and the importance of a credible narrative. And in 21st and 21 lessons for the 21st century, you point at the fact that the main question mark that humankind faces is not so much the meaning of life, but rather how we can get rid of suffering, or how we can be freed of suffering. And you also point at the fact that when we abandon fictional narrative, it's easier to understand reality. So today, there is a great deal of atomization, and we all choose what to believe. We all choose our own reality and our own version of things. Today, there are so many means to build up our own little individual realities and to believe that all the rest are wrong. How can we get to understand each other? How can we keep building up our civilizations?
I think that, you know, when we talk about the power of stories and fictional stories, it's crucial to remember that there is reality. Not everything is a story. And the ultimate reality, or the most powerful reality, is the reality of suffering. If you want to know whether the hero of your story is real or it's a fictional entity, you should ask a simple question. Can it suffer? Banks can't suffer. Money can't suffer. Corporations can't suffer. Even nations can't suffer. Nations don't have a mind. They don't have a nervous system. If they lose a war, they don't feel pain. They don't feel sad. Humans suffer. Animals suffer. Cows suffer. They are real. So whenever also you're thinking about, if there is a story which is very dear to you, a very important thing you need to do is ask, is there anybody who is suffering because of my story or the story that I try to impose on society? And if there is somebody like that, it doesn't mean that you immediately give your story up, because almost every big story causes some amount of suffering to some people. So it's not like immediately abandon it, but listen to these people. If there are people who suffer because of the story that you promote, it's your duty to at least listen to them. Listen to their story. Listen to their experiences. And take into account that maybe you are wrong to some extent. And the great thing about stories is that they can be changed very quickly. Something, you know, suffering which is because of the laws of nature, like disease, you can't change it very easily. It's like a long time. It's very hard to protect humans from disease. But suffering which is caused by a fictional story, it's very easy and quick to change that story. If you think, for instance, about the persecution of LGBT people, you know, for centuries, they have been persecuted and suffered tremendously. And to prevent all this suffering, you didn't need any new technology. You didn't need any scientific breakthrough. You didn't need to invest billions of dollars. You just needed to change the story very quickly, relatively easily. And we see a tremendous change in recent years.
So I would agree that we humans, indeed, we are the stories that we tell ourselves. There's this great book published in the 80s by the philosopher Peter Singer. And it's called The Expanding Circle. And in the book, he describes basically the moral progress that we've made over the centuries. You know, in the very deep past, our moral circle was very small. You know, it was maybe just a family or it was just a tribe. And then as history progressed, we expanded that circle. We expanded our circle of people or maybe even animals that we give moral concern. There was one really important moment in 1780 when a philosopher called Jeremy Bentham wrote a footnote. It's perhaps one of the most important footnotes written in ever, where he makes the argument that we could keep on expanding it. You know, Jeremy Bentham was one of the first people who argued for the equality of the sexes. He was one of the first people who said we should decriminalize homosexuality. Okay, he didn't have the courage to actually publish that. They only found that out years and years later, but he did think it. But he also made, indeed, this point that Yuval just made in the case of animals. The point is not, can they reason? The point is not, can they talk? The point is, can they suffer? Mm. And if they can suffer, then that is reason enough to include there in our circle of moral concern. Now, there's a tool called Google Ngram, where you can look at how often certain words are used in the English language. So what you can see is, for example, you can Google Ngram civil rights. And then you see that indeed in the 18th century, people start talking more and more about civil rights, and then it increases more and more in the 19th century. Then you could look at women's rights, and that actually starts in the 19th century. And you see it going up and up and up as you know, the women's movement rises. And children's rights, that's actually at the late 19th century. So you see the circle, it keeps on expanding and expanding. And it's only logical, you know, because once you start caring about, you know, a certain group of people, then why not take the next step? You know, this, for example, in the 1960s, during the second wave of feminism, it became logical for people to say, but why not, you know, care about LGBT as well? Just as now, you know, there's the whole trans movement and people saying we should expand it even further. And now if you look in Google Ngrams and you look at animals' rights, that's actually the biggest recent rise. And we could think about this, you know, how to extrapolate it. Maybe sometime in the future we'll be worrying about the suffering of artificial intelligence. That sounds maybe very weird right now, but if it is true that computers will keep getting smarter and smarter, probably one of the first things that will originate within this artificial intelligence is not the ability to talk or the ability to reason. Maybe it will be the ability to suffer, because maybe that is much more rudimentary than some of the other abilities. Now, that may sound completely crazy, but that's the whole thing about history. Things that sound completely crazy at one point may become reality in the future.
So this question is double-faced, so to speak. There's a revolution of women in Iran. Do you believe this proves that change is possible? And now, another question related to the previous one. Oftentimes, we have the feeling that it's over, there's nothing else we can do. Why is it so difficult to rethink the world? Perhaps is it because we don't ask ourselves questions anymore? We don't think about how to rethink the world? Are we becoming lazy? Are we expecting others to find the answer about how to reshape the world, how to redesign the world? And we are resigned to accepting whatever comes. I'm not talking about you two, of course, which seem quite engaged in change. But sometimes I have the feeling we are experiencing this kind of pattern.
So if I can tell a personal story about this, I'm 34 years old, and maybe you think that's not very old. But sometimes I already feel old. I recently visited my old student society in Utrecht in the Netherlands, and I was just astounded by the general generational difference that I saw there. So when I was a student 10, 12 years ago, we never worried about climate change. You know, we flew around Europe with Ryanair. It was very cheap and it was wonderful. You know, I visited Barcelona as well, by the way, and drank a lot of beer. We never had any discussions about, say, factory farming or animal suffering. I remember we had two vegetarians, and we made fun of them all the time. I was probably one of the worst bullies, I'm sorry. We didn't have, you know, discussions about sexual harassment, for example. This was pre-Me Too. So I've actually seen a lot of progress. If you look at young people today, in many places, they are much more progressive and idealistic than people used to be. This is also, by the way, a global phenomenon, so just the number of protest movements has gone up a lot. The thing to worry about here is that it's not clear that they're very effective. So there's a great researcher called Erica Chenoweth, and she's done a lot of research into the question, are peaceful protest movements more successful or violent protest movements more successful? And the data, you know, over the last century was pretty clear, is that peaceful protest movements are way more successful because they draw in a lot more people, you know, like 12 or 13 times more people. It's not just the angry young guys with too much testosterone participating, but it's really much broader. But then if you look at some of the recent protest movements, there is this worrying tendency of basically a lack of results. Maybe it's partly due to social media, is that today it's very easy to create a hashtag and, you know, make a big splash, and suddenly there are lots of people in the public square, but that's not, you know, an effective organization just yet. Changing the world is so much more than, you know, just shouting from the rooftops and posting on Twitter, etc. I mean, that's an essential part, but it's also about, you know, how do you actually change the legislation, right? What do you do about this procedure? You know, what do you do on the local level, the provincial level, the national level? I mean, there's so many different roles to play in a movement. And sometimes I think the problem today is that these movements break out very quickly, and then they're on the stage, and they haven't prepared all that well yet. So I'm very hopeful, obviously, about what's going on in Iran, but I'm also worried that this may fade quickly again, because just the organization is not there yet.
Yeah, I would agree in emphasizing the importance of organizations and institutions, because, you know, the initial shock, say, to the regime, it can come from a kind of spontaneous movement. But to make real lasting changes in history, it's always about institutions. It's always about organizations. I mean, 50 people in an organization can make a much, much bigger and lasting change than 500 individual activists. And this is something that also oppressive regimes know, which is why the kind of the number one job of every autocratic regime is to break down any alternative institution or organization, no matter what their goal are. I mean, in the extreme cases of totalitarian regimes, every time that people in significant numbers meet together, it must be under the supervision of the regime, of the totalitarian state. So in a totalitarian state, you can't have a football club. You can't have an environmental organization. You can't have a charity organization unless it's sanctioned and directed by the party or by the regime. Because whenever people get together for any reason, and build trust between them and learn how to cooperate, this is a threat to the regime. And conversely, democratic societies get their strength exactly from these organizations, from this ability to build trust between people. So, you know, we talked about trust at the beginning of our discussion with regard to bankers and money and so forth, but it's the basis for everything. It's also the basis for a successful revolution. It's also the basis for making lasting social changes. So, you know, anybody who wants to change the world, the question they face is ultimately, how do we build institutions that, you know, kind of incorporate our ideals, an ideal that has no institution to implement it will not succeed.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you very much to both of you. If you agree, we'll now open for the Q&A session. We've got microphones for you. Wait a second, please.
So my question was for both of you. What do you feel about the idea of having your phone in front of your face and paging people for the proof of humanity? So we could make people a universal basic income just for existing and pay to the country the actual amount of people that he has in there, not to the government, but for the people, for having babies, and having an economy just by the law, by if you have a good family and you know how to evolve and you know how to do these things right, money for you. You are a good country. Money for you, money for you, money for you, money for you.
Gracias. Creo que ya me entendéis. Gracias.
I'm not sure I fully understand the question. But I am a big fan of the idea of giving everyone a basic income. It's an idea that's been around for at least 200 years. I mean, Thomas Paine, one of the founding fathers of the United States, already pointed us in this direction. People basically forgot about it. It was quite popular in the 70s, but ever since then, it's come back in the last couple of years. this radical notion that we could just pay people for being alive and that we could just completely eradicate poverty in that way. Now, most people would say this will never work because people are naturally lazy and they're naturally selfish, so, you know, they'll just waste the money on drugs or alcohol. But that's obviously an empirical question. So indeed, in one of my books, Utopia for Realists, I tried to look at the evidence we actually have of how people behave when they receive a basic income. And it turns out it works pretty well in most cases. You could even call it venture capital for the people. If you give people the freedom to decide for themselves what they want to do with their own lives, sure, some people will waste it. Some might even become historians. But I think the vast majority of people would do, you know, real useful stuff, and you'll unleash a huge amount of creativity in that way. It could be one of the most efficient ways even to build trust and to eradicate poverty. I'm not sure if you need the whole technology part you mentioned, but I'm not sure I fully got that.
My main issue with universal basic income is the universal part of it. Most people who talk seriously about universal basic income, they actually mean national basic income. They have this idea that, say, in the United States, the government, you'll have this huge automation revolution, big corporations, say, in California, making lots of money, people in other parts of the country losing their jobs, and the government steps in and takes taxes from the big corporations and gives UBI to all the people. The problem is that the biggest problems will not be in the US. The biggest problems in this scenario will be in Guatemala, will be in El Salvador, will be in Pakistan. Now, I don't see any political scenario, at least not in the world that we live in now, that any US government, even a Democratic, not a Republican government, taking taxes from California and using it to give people income in Pakistan. It's not going to happen. And the big question, and this is why I'm worried when people talk about it, because I think that they're only thinking about the local problem in their own country. The really, really big problem will be on the global level. Countries like the US, they are going to become even richer and more powerful thanks to the new technologies. So they will be able, either with UBI or by retraining the workforce or in other ways, to take care of their citizens. The really big problem is who is going to take care of all the people who lose their jobs and lose their futures in El Salvador or in Pakistan. And UBI doesn't really address this question. So this is my issue with the idea.
So I guess I would be in favor of being even more utopian, right? And introduce a global universal basic income. Maybe we could start a political party together to achieve that.
Who is going to vote for it?
Yeah, that's probably we've got one vote here, Yuval. We've got one vote.
But who is going to vote for it in the coming November elections in the US?
Sure, of course. I think that's actually also the problem now with the European energy crisis. So what I see is that all these European countries on a national level have all these discussions about solidarity, right? We need to subsidize the energy bills of those who can't afford right now. But what is the effect of that on a global level? What recently happened, for example, in Pakistan, is that they have long-term contracts to get their LNG, you know, their liquid gas. And what do the providers of the LNG say? They say, well, we'll break up the contract and we'll just pay the fee to do that, because the Europeans now, they're paying us a shitload of money. We're getting so rich. Basically, we're out-competing the rest of the world as Europeans. So what now happens in Pakistan and Bangladesh and other places is they've got the blackouts. So we've just basically pushed the blackouts out of Europe and given them to poorer countries. And I see very little of that in the whole discussion about the energy crisis. It's all about, you know, European solidarity. Our people need to have their electricity and gas, etc. And sure, I understand where that's coming from. But sometimes it's important to just zoom out and to realize that what we do has global effects.
So we have time for one or two more questions, and there are more than two.
Pleasure to hear both perspectives. I was just thinking and reasoning about, what you said, Roger, about the marketing effect of online digital tools like Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. They are not that effective. I was just thinking, though, they are really effective in breaking our undivided attention to focus on the real problem. So maybe we can talk, and I want to hear your position about the growing body of research on breaking undivided attention, suicide rates on adolescents on Instagram. I mean, there is some research there that is addressing this topic. And yeah, maybe they are not so fine-tuned to sell products, but they are very good into creating stories, and we talked about this, and to give value to brands, to perspectives, to create stories. They are not really nice. And extremist groups, for example, are really, there's a nice, that's a nice place to grow extremist groups. So I wanted to hear from you.
Absolutely. So I think we need to be very careful and nuanced here. The historian in me would say, look, there have been moral panics around so many new technologies. You know, when the bicycles came, people said, oh, that's very dangerous for your health. When television came, they say, oh, that will destroy society. So this happens every single time. Now people are very worried about conspiracy thinking and fake news spreading on YouTube and on Twitter and places like that. But fake news and conspiracy thinking have been around since, well, for a very, very long time, right? So I think that's important to keep in mind. Yes, there is more and more evidence that, I mean, obviously social media and these technologies are incredibly addictive, and there's more and more evidence coming in that especially for teenage girls, the effect seems to be really, really bad. But we're also in the midst of this experiment. So I'm curious to hear what Yuval thinks, if this is really such a you know, terrible disaster going on, or if it's more of a moral panic.
Well, I mean, there are conflicting evidence, and there is also conflicting things happening on the ground. One thing, very good thing about social media, for example, is that it unleashed an enormous flood of creativity. You mentioned television. Back in the 80s, the 90s, the main kind of model of the average person was the couch potato, the person who just sits in front of a screen and does absolutely nothing. And now the engine that fuels these social media, it's the creativity of everybody. I mean, the YouTube videos or the Instagrams or the TikTok videos, who is producing them? They are produced by the actual users. People got up from the couch and started dancing and filming themselves. So it unleashed this flood of creativity. I mean, but there are, of course, things to worry about. What really worries me, and I'm not sure if it is related to social media, maybe yes, maybe no, this is the big question mark. What we do see for certain in many societies, especially in democratic countries, is the breakdown of conversation. That people are losing the ability to talk politically with one another. It seems that the information system is broken. That even though the ideological divides are actually smaller than they were 50 years ago, Democrats and Republicans in the US, for instance, are no longer able to have a conversation. And this is very dangerous, because when people can't talk to each other, the only thing left for them to do is to fight. Civil wars and conflicts, they don't necessarily erupt because of big ideological divides. People can fight about stupid things. If you look at the wars of religion in Europe in the early modern period, today we look back, we can't understand what they are fighting about. It seemed to them very important. They were unable to have any meaningful discussion about their theological differences. But looking back, it seems that they are absolutely crazy to fight about it. And this can happen again. When people lose the ability to have a conversation, even relatively small differences can cause big conflicts. And what I do know is that we see this this global phenomenon of people losing the ability to have a meaningful conversation with their political rivals. What is the cause of it? A lot of arrows are pointing in the direction of social media and technology, but I'm not sure. I think we need to look at it. It should be one of our top priorities, because democracies cannot survive under this condition. And we see it in so many different countries. with different political and social situation, that it does seem to have something to do with our new information technology, but I'm posing it as a question more than as an exclamation mark of something we know for sure.
You know, there's an old research tradition in psychology called contact theory, and it's basically about this question: what do we do about prejudice? What do we do about racism? And what do we do about hatred? And we've now have more than hundreds and hundreds of studies that again and again show that contact, real, you know, life, face-to-face, human contact, is one of the best medicines we have there. It's something that we should keep in mind, that biologically, you know, we've evolved to meet each other in real life, right? So one of the striking facts, for example, about humans is that we are the only animal, at least among mammals, but maybe even in the whole animal kingdom, with the ability to blush, right? We involuntarily give away our feelings to other members of our species in order to establish trust. We are the only primate, and there are more than 200 primates in total, who've got white sclera, as they call it. So maybe you can see it, now I'm looking to the left, now I'm looking to the right, because you can track my gaze. If I would have been a chimpanzee, that would have been difficult, right? So Yuval's now able to see that I'm looking at him, and I'm looking at the screen. That is again, unique about humans. And there are some scientists and evolutionary anthropologists who argue that this has helped us in the course of our evolution to cooperate on larger and larger scales. But obviously, it's hard to replace these kind of things in a digital era. You know, there are some things about human interactions that are just have to be physical, you know, again, touching each other, you know, that's a very important way to build trust as well. So that is something to keep in mind as well, is that there are just some things about human connections that just have to happen in real life.
Open a dialogue touching each other, meeting indeed is very important to enhance thinking. And here we are in the Biennale del Pensament. Thank you. It's been an immense pleasure. Thank you to all of you.
Bye, Yuval.
Bye-bye.